Hi, I'm Brian Holt. I'm a senior program manager on Visual Studio Code and Azure at Microsoft, and welcome to the complete intro to containers. I created this course because I believe containers are becoming ever more important. In the future, I believe that every developer will need to know how to use containers, and this course will help you get ahead of the curve. In this course, we'll go over what containers are and how to construct them by hand, how to run containers from Dockerhub, how to create your own containers with Dockerfiles, and what the best practices are with Frontend and Node.js code with Docker, as well as how to use containers for development environments. I hope you enjoy the course. So we're going to do this. We're going to run a Docker Alpine container. And we've kind of been doing this already, and I've just been kind of like saying, like, don't peek behind the curtain yet. Now we're going to peek behind the curtain. So I'm going to come back here to VS Code. I'm here in Mac OS. And I'm going to say Docker run dash dash interactive dash dash TTY. Yep. I can never remember. Run. And then at that point, once you've done this, you can run basically anything that you want to run. In this particular case, I want to run, let's say, Alpine, right? Which is a flavor of Linux. So I'm going to say Alpine. And this is what's coming off of Dockerhub, right? Which is what we were looking at previously. Now I could say Docker run Alpine, and this would implicitly run colon latest, right? Which would be the latest version that they've published, right? Now I'm going to suggest that you never use latest. It's just kind of a foot gun. And in particular, since people will be watching this course later, I'm going to be very explicit about the versions that I'm using, because I want these demos to work for you with the code that I've written. So I'm going to say 3.10, which I think is one of the more recent ones. Now, if you haven't installed this or pulled this previously, it'll take a second, say, downloading all these layers, and it'll take a second. I think Alpine, the final image ends up being like, I don't know, 20 some odd megabytes or something like that. And that's the point of Alpine. Alpine is like tiny Linux, right? It has just like the bare bones necessity for like running web servers and stuff like that, and nothing else. And I think we'll get more into that later. There's a whole section just talking about Alpine. But again, you can say cat etc issue, and we can see, welcome to Alpine Linux 3.10. That's expected, given that we asked for Alpine 3.10. Now, this probably seems a little bit easier than what we were doing before, which is like exporting and doing control groups and unshares. This just did all of that for you. So really, any old Docker file is going to work. So let's just copy the one from, and we're just going to copy that into a new Docker file here. Basically, we just need a working node application. So this one that does, you know, copies everything over, runs the npm install. Don't need the expose. You can delete that. And then the command here of node index.js, right? The key here is that we just need to start the node application in a working environment. So I'm going to come in here to, where am I? I'm in networking. So I'm going to say docker build dash dash tag, and we'll call this like node with Mongo or something like that. You can call whatever you want. What do I call it here? App with Mongo. So we'll just stick to that. App with Mongo. Dot. That'll take a second to build. And this should be packaged up and ready to go. And there we go. So now we're going to run this app and connect to the other database that's running. So we're going to say docker run dash p 3000 colon 3000 dash dash network equals app dash net dash dash env. We have to tell it where to connect, right? So we're going to say mongo connection string equals mongodb colon slash slash db colon 27017. Again, remember, if you put db, it's going to know because they're on the same network that db goes over to the db container because we named it. And then we're going to run it with app with mongo or whatever you call it, your container. I think my notes actually say my app with Mongo. As long as you call it the same thing, it doesn't actually matter. So you can see it started up correctly, and now if I go over here to 3,000 or localhost 3,000, you can see that it has this count number. Can I make that bigger? Oh, I can. So that's what we expect. It has nothing in that collection right now. If I open it with slash add, then it's going to say, cool, I inserted something. And now if I go back to the other one and refresh, you can see that its count is 1. Or if I come back over here and just hit refresh a bunch of times, and I go back over here to slash, you can see now I have 18 items in the database. So now I have one container, the app with Mongo container talking to the MongoDB container, and they're doing it via the app network that we set up for ourselves. So coming back over to our project here, compose, I want you to click here on compose, which is compose.io. This is an official project from the Kubernetes organization, which is part of the Cloud Native Foundation, which I believe is part of the Linux Foundation. Okay, and then I want you to come in here, and I think there's an installation tab right there. And it's another curl command that you're going to download and run. And right there, that's the one that you want. You're going to have to do the same kind of song and dance, make it executable with plus X, and then move that into your path. And it looks like it will work on Windows as well. It looks like they have a binary that you just install from GitHub. But again, I think you're stuck in PowerShell land. OK. So now that I have compose, you should, is it just version? There you go. I have 1.19. And the next thing that we need to do is we need to go modify our Docker compose file a little bit to work with this. So that's what compose does for you, is it takes a Docker compose file that we wrote, and it turns that into a Kubernetes configuration, which is pretty cool, because Docker compose is pretty easy by comparison to understand to Kubernetes configurations. So as long as we're good building Docker compose files, we can be using Kubernetes. And what you can do, and what I do personally, when I'm messing around with Kubernetes, I'll start with the Docker compose file. I'll use compose to convert everything to Kubernetes output, and then I'll go from there. OK, so we're going to come into our Docker compose.yml. We're going to change the image, or the build, to an image, because it won't do builds for us. That's one thing that compose will not do for you, nor Kubernetes. So I want you to change this to btholt/node-app. So this is on Dockerhub. It's literally the app that we've been building this whole time. I just built it and pushed it to Dockerhub so that we can do this. But you have to go through a registry. So whether that's running your own registry locally, or that's pushing it to GitHub package registry, or pushing it to Dockerhub, or Azure container registry, there's a bunch of different places you can push these. For now, we're just going to use Dockerhub because that's the easiest one. OK, ports 3000. And we're going to get rid of this volumes part because you don't use Kubernetes for development purposes. So that's all this stuff is not useful. We're going to put ports back if you took that out like I did, which is 3000:3000. Links DB, that's fine. Environment, that's fine. We got to add one more, though, which is labels. So there's certain things that Kubernetes needs to know about our particular service. And one of them is that this is a load balancing service, which means that it needs to have like some sort of load balancer in front of it. So if you want to have 10 containers running at the same time, Kubernetes can do that load balancing for us. So Docker Compose doesn't have this concept of load balancing built into it. So we have to kind of indicate to Compose, like, hey, please put this into the Kubernetes load balancing situation. So you say compose.service.type, and you just say this is a load balancer. So labels are typically more used for things like this is a database container. And then it makes it easy for you to like search through your clusters to find things. They're just labels in that sense. OK, and last thing here on, we have to give the database explicit ports to be using. So we're going to say, please put this on 27017. So I need you to do kind of a hack here. This is for how Compose is expected to work. It needs some way to talk to your kube control. So you're going to run this kube control proxy port 8080. And it's just going to start serving traffic on port 8080. You can actually take a look at it, I think. It's nothing exciting, if I remember correctly. Yeah, it's basically an API for anyone to interact with your kube control, right? It's kind of exposing that to your local computer. OK? So I don't want to run that in the foreground. You can actually just say, if I put and here at the end, it's going to run it in the background. So now if I look at my computer, which I obviously have a lot of things, so if I do ps aux grep kubectl, you can see here it's running here in the background. That's what that and does at the end, is it forces stuff into the background. You can do that with like screen and tmux and a bunch of other stuff too. I'm just lazy and don't use those. All right, so now that's running. And this won't work, by the way, if you don't do that. So now we have compose. We're going to say compose up. And you can see here, it created a DB service, it created a web service, it created a deployment for both of these, and everything's running in the default namespace. So in theory, we should be able to come here and say localhost 3000. And it's working now within Kubernetes.